We're calling to get, calling to order the regular meeting of the Board of Directors of the Bastrop Economic Development Corp., May 16th at 6:01. Still. All right, first on our agenda is public comments, and we have one commenter, Carolyn Banks. And if anyone else wants to speak, please go out of line.
Well, what's the typical procedure? Do I stand on the X?
Wherever you'd like.
That's actually for our presenter, so please feel free to stand wherever you like.
That's a plus. That's not a X.
Okay. Well, I am Carolyn Banks. I founded an organization, a nonprofit, called Upstart in the year 2000. It was a solid community organization that did a lot of community events and helped people, introduce people to media that they could use themselves. My last act as a member of the Board of Directors was to write a grant to LCRA for $24,000 to renovate the last of three buildings on Upstart's property, a city block within the city limits. So as a requirement, one-fifth of the funds had to come from some other organization. LCRA required this. And what we did was ask Dave Quinn to participate, and he contributed $6,000. Those funds were misused, and LCRA asked Upstart to give the $24,000 that it had awarded back. And I have a letter here from LCRA stating that they did this and that they successfully got their funds back. When I asked BEDC to write a demand letter to Upstart for the $6,000 that had been misused, I was told that they didn't have proof that Upstart and BEDC had entered into a contract. So I am here to present the proof so that BEDC will perhaps not enter into complex and expensive legal negotiations, but to write a simple demand letter to Donald Barron of Upstart, asking for the return of this $6,000. It was initially given to Upstart to create something called a makerspace, a community space which would be a place where people could come and use tools and other equipment, art supplies, sewing machines to make things. It was not used for this purpose. Donald Barron canceled the event that was to open the makerspace, although he used the $24,000 and the $6,000 to renovate the building. His own company did that. He's a contractor. And rented it to a private entity. So what I want to distribute to BEDC in the hope that it will seek the return of these funds is a letter from LCRA, a picture and article in the Bastrop Advertiser dated February 8th, 2014, showing the check being given to Upstart, with Dave Quinn, who was then the head of BEDC, in the photograph, clearly stating that it was for the makerspace. I also have some minutes from Upstart. Oh, and I have a letter from Dave Quinn that accompanied the grant application. Stating that it was for the makerspace. And I think it would be very important to allow Donald Barron to exercise his honesty and grace and return the $6,000. And I also think it would help other serious and honest nonprofits when they approach BEDC to support their own projects. Now, if JC, and let me give you your copy, ma'am. If JC is the person who instructed you, and I believe I have an email from Sean indicating that it was not possible to attempt to retrieve these funds, then I would suggest you seek another legal opinion. Thank you very much. Do you have any questions?
It's citizens' comments, and so they can't ask or comment back.
Well, if you do, my address and phone number and email is listed on the first copy.
Thank you, Carolyn.
You're welcome.
Are there any other public comments? All right, moving into regular business, item 3.1 is approval of the meeting minutes of the regular board meeting of April 18th. Those are on page 4 of your packet.
I move that we approve the minutes of April 18th.
Second? Sorry. Or who? Okay, Cam seconded, yeah. And all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes.
You have to ask for the opposed, please.
Oh, opposed. Thank you. Item 3.2, consideration, discussion, and possible action on acceptance of the BEDC's financial summary report for period ending April 30th, 2016.
So, Sean. So page 8 has the financial report for the period ending April 30th. For FY16, we've brought in $1.215 million in sales tax, or 62.9% of the budget. For expenditures, year-to-date, at the end of the month, we've spent $877,516, or 45.4% of budget. Looking at the charts and graphs, we're tracking right along on revenues as well as on sales tax. We've had a healthy few months now of sales tax increases. Looking at the expenditure chart, it continues to come in line with where we think we'll end up the end of the year. As we've made our debt service payments for the year, and we see the rest of our expenses kind of come into line with where we think we should be for the year. Looking at the expenditure chart, we're tracking right along with what is kind of our traditional expenditures with March and the end of April. And then this is just a repeat of the 15-16 budget of the fund balance available on September 30th, 2016. There were no anomalies in the financial statements that need to be brought to the board's attention.
Move that we accept the financial summary.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Item 3.3, consideration, discussion, and possible action on presentation and update by Aaron Farmer, the retail coach, regarding Bastrop's retail recruiting strategy. Sean?
So, every budget year since 2011, the EDC has retained the services of the retail coach, and Aaron Farmer is our representative with them. He lives in Dripping Springs, so he's right down the road from us and readily available. He comes to Bastrop at least once a quarter. We see him probably every other month out and about doing what he does for us. They do a lot of different things for us, but if you've ever looked at our demographic, psychographic, retail trade area, gap analysis, that's all performed by the retail coach. We also work with them in doing what's called a retailer match list and refining our retail recruitment of specific retailers, as well as targeting developers to put in retail developments to suit our retailer target match list. But I will turn it over to him so I don't give his whole presentation.
Perfect. Well, thanks, Sean, and it's great to be in front of you again. Like Sean mentioned, just real quick, a little bit about our firm. We've evolved over the last 6 years that we've been working with the EDC, and really what you see up on the screen here, we are your project leaders. Kelly Kofer, our president and CEO, has been with this project since the inception, created the retail coach back in 2000. I am what we call our project manager. I'm the one who's here in Bastrop on a regular basis. I was looking back since 2000, I made 18 trips to Bastrop on meeting with potential retailers, developers, meeting with the EDC. So feel like we know the community back and forth. I like to say if we're gonna go out there and recruit retailers and restaurants or even work with existing businesses, we really have to know what's happening on every corner. You know, what properties are available. And we'll talk more about that as we move forward. It stopped working, John.
Well, what did you do to it? Okay,
there we go. A few other of our staff here, but like I said, I've been partners since 2010. Back in 2010, we were able to meet with several retailers just in the beginning to get them started. Worked closely with the developer back in 2010 as well, Derman and Bassett, and their representative, Barry Hayden. We've seen a lot of that retail that we've helped recruit to Bastrop go to that development, but now we're talking about other properties that are available, other retailers, or other areas for retail. So I want to just bring to your attention, and I know most of you have seen this, but the retail trading, this is what separates Bastrop from other communities, you know, in the 8,000 or so population range. Your retail trade area for a community is something really that I can't say I've seen another community of your size have a trade area this large. And when I talk about trade area, I'm talking about those consumers that are shopping in Bastrop on a regular basis. Okay, you don't have much competition at all, really, to the south and to the southeast. So your trade area of people shopping in your stores extends all the way down to Interstate 10. And it's hard for a lot of these retailers to get there initially, to really wrap their brains around this, that you're pulling from such a large distance, but you are. And we're even seeing your retail trade area extend further towards Austin. People that want to avoid going to Austin, avoid going to the going into the traffic there, they're coming to shop in Bastrop, especially with the addition of Academy, the addition of Hobby Lobby, other retailers and restaurants that have come in recently. So it's amazing to see how large your trade area is. So what I wanted to show you here is your trade area population has jumped up to just over 187,000 people that are shopping in Bastrop on a regular basis. Now, from a population of roughly 8,000 to 187,000, that's a huge retail trade. That's why some of your larger retailers have decided to locate here. You also have a strong income. Your incomes are in the 60 plus thousand, greater than the state average. So we're seeing retailers really look at this information, and this is key. When we sit down, and Sean can kind of attest to this, but we went to the International Council of Shopping Centers Convention in Dallas last year in November, and we sit down with these retailers, sit down with these developers, and they just, you know, it astounds them to see 187,000 in a retail trade area. So I wanted to, these are 2016 numbers, so I just wanted to share with you the new numbers that I've come across. We literally have hundreds of pages of demographic information, but those are the ones that stand out the most, is that trade area population and how large it is. What's something new this year that we put into our process is you probably remember me talking last time I was here about a license plate analysis, where we can go scan license plates and find out where consumers were coming from to shop in Bastrop. That's one of the ways we were able to determine that trade area. Now we have the capability to also do a cell phone analysis. And it's scary to think about, but when you go into a store, so let's say you walk into the new Hobby Lobby, and you get a phone call, an email, or a text, your satellite or your GPS signal pings up to a satellite, and that information is tracked. So you can see we've developed a system here for tracking that. The blue dots represent consumers that were shopping in Bastrop over the last year. Now, what's even cooler with this,
where their phones are registered?
Where their phones are registered. So it's not a perfect science if you're, say you have a business phone and it registers maybe back to your company, but we like to get enough of a sample that it kind of gets rid of those outliers. So the blue dots represent where those consumers are coming from, but what's really neat about this is we can track it based on time of day. So we can track it based on breakfast, we can track it based on lunch, dinner, evening, and this is new. This is something we've had for about a week or so now. Sean, I don't think you've even seen this yet. It's scary, right? But you can understand from a retailer's point of view, having access to this kind of information is key. So where I really see this being useful is obviously showing where the consumers are coming from, but I really see that little tab where I can click lunchtime. and I can click lunch, and it shows us who's here during lunchtime. That's really going to help us get over that hump of getting some of those more high-caliber, sit-down, casual-type restaurants we've looked at forever. So this is going to be a tool we use starting tomorrow in this process. So I wanted to share that with you. You know, after we run these cell phone analysis, we might need to make a few tweaks to that trade area. Maybe we need to extend it further in one direction than we do in another. So I wanted to share this with you. It's hot off the press, but really, really neat tool to have here, and it's something the retailers are really using. But
would this information be available, be useful for example, our destination marketing folks who are trying to get tourists to come here?
It would. We can actually, so we have been tracking, or the company that we partner with to do this has been tracking Bastrop for a year. So we can go back in time using this system for an entire year to see who was shopping here. You know, say you've got an event going on, you know, during a certain weekend. We can specifically look at that one weekend and see where those consumers are coming from. So I really see the tourism aspects, you know, destination style marketing can use this as well. And we'll sit down with whoever we need to kind of go through that information as well. Good example. There's a large Christian event that's going to be taking place at Dell Diamond, and we are going to be doing a cell phone analysis out there to be able to track those consumers that are going to that concert that's going to take place in August. So that's a great way to use the cell phone analysis. So that's just a little bit of the data. We literally, like I said, have hundreds of pages of data, but I just wanted to kind of share what we've been working on the last few months. But data is only part of the process, and that's kind of ties into with our company model of moving beyond data. Our process is much more detailed. I was here last month, I guess it was, with Sean, and we were really looking at a land use analysis, a retail land use analysis. Now, we've got to look at other areas for retail. A lot of the newer national retailers that we've been successful at bringing in have been focused on that Burleson Crossing area. Well, we've got to look at other areas in town. I think Eric's going to talk a little bit about that today as well, but we're identifying specific sites. What sites are not serving their highest and best use? Is it a redevelopment site? Is it a shopping center that needs to be redeveloped? Is it a something that's not serving its highest and best use? We look at that, but then we also look at greenfields. Is it a large tract of land which is suitable for a mixed use type development? Mixed use is one of the things that's missing as part of this component. Is mixed use, is there a property potential for that as well? So the first question we get, and we're going to be, and I'll talk about it in a minute, but we're going to be in Vegas next week recruiting retailers and restaurants for Bastrop. And the first question we always get is, where can we put our business? What sites are available? So we're really putting a focus over the next 6 months or so on identifying specific sites and where we can put these retailers and where we can put these restaurants. So Sean alluded to it, but we also have developed retailer and developer match list. So these are retailers and these are developers that should be here, okay, should be in Bastrop based on the numbers. You match their criteria as far as trade area population. You match their criteria for income, age, those sort of things. So we've got a list. Right now, our retailer list is roughly 30 or so that we're focused on recruiting. We're in active dialogue with all of these, with most of those retailers right now. And then we've got a list of about 50 developers that we're reaching out to that are active in the region. So I'm excited to see where this is headed over the next 6 months, but wanted to share that with you. Now, last couple of slides. A big part of this is marketing, and that's my background is marketing. So I understand, you know, you've got to get this information in front of the retailers, but you want to get rid of the fluff. Retailers only want to see the information that is pertinent to them. So we develop specific marketing packages. Good example, and I don't want to say we're the only reason Hobby Lobby's here, but we were working to recruit Hobby Lobby for several years to come to Bastrop. So they had their own what we call feasibility package or marketing package that we sent to Hobby Lobby to say, look, you can't afford not to locate in Bastrop, and here's why. And it was specific information, knowing Hobby Lobby, knowing who they look for. So all of the retailers, all of the developers get their own packages like that. We're working right now on these site profiles, which I talked about identifying those sites. We've got a retail website that we use. We've got property visuals. We've got developer packaging that we're putting together. So marketing is a big component of this, moving beyond that data. We also have an interactive mapping application, and this is a pretty neat tool. Instead of just providing reports to you, providing reports to retailers and developers, we've developed an interactive mapping application where we can click, and you can kind of see the interface, what it looks like here. We can click up here and we can say, show us the retail spending potential. And that's what's on the screen here. And what it does is it color codes, and the darker the blue around Bastrop is, the higher the retail spending potential in the community. We can type in specific sites, we can zoom to specific sites. So if we're meeting with a retailer or developer and they want to see demographics, there's literally hundreds of layers they can click on to see specific demographics. Maybe it's a retailer, maybe it's a fast casual restaurant that's looking for a certain age group. Maybe they're looking for 20 to 30s. We can put that into the system. It'll create a map for us, color code it, and show it where the highest percentage of 20 to 30 year olds are in Bastrop. So all of this obviously has evolved since we started in 2010, 2011 time period. And that's because the retail industry is evolving. With what Amazon's doing, with what other retailers are doing, these brick and mortar stores are having to evolve themselves. So wanted to share that with you. And then we are going to be representing Bastrop in Las Vegas, May 22nd through the 25th. So that's next Sunday through Wednesday. And we've got meetings with potential retailers and restaurants, potential developers at this conference. You can see what our booth looks like out there. You will be well represented at that conference. And then we'll come back to Sean, and then Sean and I will have meetings with these retailers and developers to follow up on. So we've got about 6 months or so left in our current contract with the EDC. And we look at this as a long-term project like we have in the beginning, but I think we've just got to continue to evolve, continue to get new information in front of these retailers, and we'll continue to see success.
Part of what you and I have talked about a lot is, as we've looked at our retailer match list, is having, and the segue into what Eric's going to talk about,
exactly,
is having what we refer to as entitled sites that are shovel ready for 200,000, 250,000 square feet to come online in a relatively swift basis, with Burleson Crossing having one junior anchor left and having two pad sites, and then what the inline space that's available. The targeting gets a little bit more difficult when we can't locate another junior anchor or even an anchor tenant into a development where we don't have an entitled site.
Exactly. Sean hit the nail on the head. That's what him and I have been talking about over the last few months, is we really have to be ready. When we're talking to these retailers next month, and we find out, okay, we've got a developer that's interested in a 250,000 square foot shopping center, well, where do we put them? And that's what that's kind of what we run into right now, is where do we put those retailers? So I think it's, and I mentioned it in the slide before, is to have a plan. This site is good for this type of retail, and plans change, but having the ideas ahead of time to work with these retailers, because at the end of the day, you're competing with all of these communities around the greater Austin area. You're competing with Dripping Springs. Dripping Springs is a growing community that's getting retail that's coming in. What happens is typically a retailer will say, we're going to open up 5 locations within the greater Austin area. And what we want to do is we want to make sure it's quick and easy to get into Bastrop for these retailers, because like I said, you're competing with them. So that kind of segues into what Eric's going to talk about. But like Sean said, having those sites ready, those, what'd you say, entitled sites ready to go for specific types of retail, I think that's going to be important, especially as we move forward in the next few years.
Any other questions for Eric?
I have a question. Is this available for anybody to look at, or is this just...
The data? Yeah, it's available on our website. We have hard copies in our office, whichever your preference is. So, yes. And anything for local retailers that need specific information, we send the request to Aaron, just like we would for somebody that we're recruiting. It's readily available. We've got a local company that is working on their tier two growth. They use the data to be able to drill down through it within their market segment to be able to project their pro forma profit and loss and top line revenue. And they use it in a very sophisticated manner as they're getting ready to go to the bank for that tier two growth. And so it's readily available to existing companies in the town, but it's also one of the things that Aaron and I and the EDC are very careful of is we don't ever go out and recruit in a space which is going to be detrimental to our existing business. We very carefully monitor the gap analysis, the slippage of retail that we're losing in the market, and make sure that what we're recruiting in is areas in which we can capture dollars that we're losing to Austin or Pflugerville or wherever it may be. And there's a couple of key areas that we know that we're going to probably turn the engine off in the next 12, 24 months unless we see population growth to drive those sectors. And so we never want to be recruiting competitors to existing businesses. What we're trying to do is recruit expanded services that the community is asking for.
And let me say something about that. So Sean mentioned the gap analysis. We also refer to it as a leakage analysis. And I know y'all have seen that before, but how much money is leaking or leaving Bastrop? Because even though you do have a good bit of retail, you still have people driving into Austin and other areas. We have a new gap analysis with the new numbers that are coming out. The new gap analysis will be ready in June. And what it does differently this year, once, like I said, just kind of trying to take everything to the next step, previously we had looked at 52 retail categories, so it wasn't as detailed as we do now. Now we're looking at 88 different retail categories, which makes sure we're really focusing on those leakage sectors and not focusing on sectors where there's a surplus or enough of something. So that'll be coming in the next month or so. I guess you'll have that for your next board meeting.
Nice.
And I thought we were Big Brother with the license plate, but we're real Big Brother now.
Yeah. It is scary.
Thank you, Aaron.
Thank you.
Other questions? Nope. Interesting. Item 3.4, consideration, discussion, and possible action on presentation and update by Eric Davis, KSA Engineering, regarding retail and commercial land development.
So Eric will be new for the board, and Aaron was supposed to be here last month, and Eric was coming this month, and it actually probably works better that they're both here together and you can ask them questions. As part of our retail recruiting strategy, and what Aaron and I have run into, Eric's firm is an expert in land development and land use planning, and we run into some site issues and not having enough available sites of the right type and flexibility that we need. And Eric's, I'm going to let Eric go through his presentation, and then I will hit on what we exactly mean, because I don't want to steal his thunder with using the terms that we use in our shop.
Well, we'll talk about some terminology. KSA is a planning and engineering firm. We're headquartered in Longview. We have about 175 employees, and we have 8 offices throughout Texas. We're pretty much a Texas-centric company. We have one office in Shreveport just because. Aaron and I work very closely together. KSA and Retail Coach work very closely together. I travel sometimes with Aaron, and I thank God that I did not travel with him today, because he just got here from Louisiana for 6.5 hours in a car with a 1-year-old and a 4-year-old. So, you know, I don't do that anymore. So that's why you have grandchildren, so you can hand them back. He's still alive. I don't even know how he does that. I am a recovering economic developer. I've been clean for over 10 years now. And I'm so glad I'm on the private sector side. Let me tell you that as an economic developer, I have boiled down economic development after working in this for 25 plus years now. That really economic development comes down to 3 things. It's real estate, it's finance, and it's workforce. Real estate, everybody, any prospect you have is either looking for a building or they're looking for a piece of land. They wouldn't be an outside prospect if they're not looking for one of those. Finance, they've got to have money to do that. Incentives, they want. So all the finance pieces tie into that. And then workforce, if there are not people here to hire and work for them, if they don't have the skill training and so forth, that's the 3 pieces. And really, once you get those 3 pieces handled, then something terrible happens and politics trumps everything and makes a mess of it. But if you can do the top three, it really, that's the whole bulk of what you're doing. So real estate's a very, very important piece of your economic development efforts, and so is politics. Here's why real estate matters. It grows your property tax base, it grows your sales tax base, it creates space for jobs, it helps the quality of life, and it helps prime the pump of economic development. So let me hit with some terminology here, because he just talked about mixed use, and this means different things to different people. Let me go through some of the retail commercial terminology that I use, and maybe you don't, but maybe we'll all be on the same page. Neighborhood strip centers. You've got a lot of these in town. These are the small, maybe they're 10,000 to 40,000 square feet buildings. They've got multiple, typically more local, sometimes some national tenants in them. And you see them in to serve a smaller retail, not 187,000 people, but a more tight geographic area. You go from that to the power centers, the ones that are looking for the 187,000 people. The power centers have an anchor that would be like a Target or a Walmart, not a Walmart so much, they tend to be standalone, but a Target or a Lowe's or a Home Depot. And then they have the junior anchors, the PetSmarts, the Rosses, the TJ Maxxes that you see in this picture. Those, the big ones will be 120,000 feet, the junior anchors will be 30,000 square feet, and then you infill those. Sean just talked about inline, that you're out of inline space a lot of times in smaller, maybe 5,000 footers, 2,000 footers in those sites. And then you have the pad sites out front for your restaurants, banks, and other pad users. A developer doesn't make any money on the anchor. He makes a little money on the junior anchors. He makes more money on the inline. He makes a lot of money on the pad sites out front. Okay, next is the what we call the retail lifestyle center. That's the more walkable feature, if you will, walkable retail. It's interesting to me because, you know, we always had air-conditioned malls. That was a big thing, to have an air-conditioned mall. Now we've turned the darn things inside out and make people walk out in the heat. And we put really nice seating around when it's 102 degrees. You'll notice in some of these pictures they have a lot of fountains, and you can imagine why. I call these inside-out malls, but they're lifestyle centers. They tend to have public space in them, or a lot of times will have public realm inside of them. Places for community to meet together, for people to hang out. That's the point of the lifestyle center. Now, if you add on top of the lifestyle center the next steps of that, which would be office uses, residential uses particularly, now that's what we would call mixed use, so that you've got a commercial and residential and retail aspect all put in together. Now, if you layer that even more with a city hall, you get what everybody calls me in every town and says, can I get one of those South Lake Town Centers? Can I get one of those Sugar Land Town Centers? Sugar Land Town Centers on the top, South Lake Town Centers on the bottom right, and the left is Frisco Town Center. They're mixed use, they're residential, they're retail, they're office, but they're anchored by city hall. Now, these are big, obviously, those are huge looking, they're in larger towns, but it works for smaller towns too. You've got people coming in, creating traffic into the city hall areas. They add the libraries in most cases into these because it creates traffic. And while you're there, you have opportunities for retail, restaurants, and then residential above it. And people really do like living vertically now. I don't. I live on 2 acres and I'm old and I can't imagine living vertically, but my kids think it's very cool to live vertically. I tell a story that my mom grew up above the shoe store that my grandfather ran and owned all his life. In fact, his father owned it. She grew up with above the store in a small place, and in Muskuta, Illinois, small town. And she just didn't understand how hip she was, because she lived with her grandmother, so she lived intergenerationally, which is all of us, right? And she lived vertically, which is all the hip. And you know that she walked to the grocery store and to the drugstore, which was down the street. I mean, of course she did. It was downtown in the small town of Muskuta. She just didn't know how hip she was. But that's what everybody's wanting to do. We're going back to Mayberry here a little bit, okay? But we're building new Mayberries, and we're calling them mixed use, and then we put the city hall in and we call them town centers. It's just a redo. Now, if we turn around and add transit to it, and this would be, for an example, in Leander, they have zoned everything around their train station in Leander for transit-oriented development. Typically, again, is mixed use and vertical living around a transit station of some sort. Could be a bus station. Okay? So that's the buzzwords that we're using right now in the development types that are going on. And I will tell you that every town I go to, I don't care what size they want, they all want this. They all want mixed-use lifestyle center. And until about 5 years ago, I just couldn't get developers. They just hated it. They wanted their power centers. They have literally, I have seen this huge change come on in about 5 years to moving towards this, even in smaller towns. Towns like Tyler that have 400 people living in downtown Tyler, you'd never think that. Marble Falls is beginning to see a little activity and interest in maybe some vertical living. You all are probably seeing some, I know you are. You've got some folks living downtown. That's a movement going on, and to build it new and vertical is a real, it'll draw people. There are people that want to live in mixed-use lifestyle centers. Lots of them. Okay, so how do we attract private investment into Bastrop? That's the real question, that's why I'm here. First of all, we talked about sites. I want you to hear this, if not anything tonight, that a cow pasture is not a commercial site. And that sounds silly, and you say, okay, well, that's real funny, Eric. But I can't tell you how many towns I go into that have cow pastures, and they say, well, there's my retail site, and there's my industrial park. And I go, where's your industrial park? And they say that, you know, that cow pasture over there. That's not an industrial park. It's not a business park. It's not a retail site. Land in Texas is everywhere. It's easy. Everybody's got land. Yeah, but we've got land on Highway 71. So what? Everybody's got land everywhere. You've got to do something to differentiate it. You need to first do the public investment, and the private investment may follow that, but private investment doesn't come in first. Private investment doesn't fix the cow pastures. It's public investment first. The private investment should follow that. And private investment follows the path of least resistance. Developers are lazy people. Real estate brokers are extremely lazy people, and I'm both. And we're just lazy. We're lazy people, and we're going to follow the path of least resistance. If you, in your retail studies, give me everything in a package, then I don't have to go trouble to put it all together. You're going to show me what you've got and tell me why I need to be here. Path of least resistance. Okay? One of the things that is a path of least resistance is, and more than a cow pasture, is, well, what's your vision? Well, we need some more retail, and we'd like to have one of those mixed-use centers here. Okay, what's your vision for that? Well, we'd like a developer to do that. Okay, but I'm bringing in $30 million or $50 million worth of investment. Does the city have any vision for this? How is my investment protected? How are your zoning set up? How's your PD set up? Are you going to work with me? Are you going to make it easy for me because I'm a lazy developer and I follow the path of least resistance? So we suggest you start out with some plan, with setting a vision, and you start out with nothing more than a basic map, and a lot of folks don't have this. You know, Aaron said, we want to know, where's your site? Retailers first ask, where's your site? We at least have to have the survey done with topo. Next, we come in and we'll say, well, what's that kind of going to look like? And we do some initial concept plans. Back of the napkin, chicken scratching, you know, just some rough, here's what might work on this land based on the topography, based on your market analysis, which you've got, based on traffic flows, based on curb cuts that we can get from TxDOT, so forth and so on. And more importantly, based on the fact that this land might be available or might not be available. I don't want to come in as a developer and have some landowner pull the rug out from under me when Sean told me this land was $4 a foot and all at once the land's $8 a foot. I've spent time to come here. You've got to have land. You don't have to have it under control, but you at least have to have agreements with landowners that they will sell it at fair price, market price, whatever that is, or a set price. We go from that to running a conceptual plan. You start tightening this up. You start putting your massing together, your square footages, your usages, how people flow inside of this. If it's lifestyle, it's more walkable. If it's power center, it's more auto-driven. It's vehicular traffic in power centers. You got to park these folks in a lifestyle center and get them out and walking. And then we go to these final concept plans. On the left is a very large kind of a power center, a little bit mixed use in Burleson that we've done. On the right is we have a planner that we have a planning group. We have a real all-star kind of high-end planner that did, for example, this is the Stockyard redevelopment on the right-hand side in historical fashion. Now, this looks like, well, you just put pretty boxes together, and how hard is architecture anyway, right? So you just put pretty boxes together, and you just throw them on a plan. And it's really much, so much more than that. It's thinking about how traffic flows and people flow and bicycles go, and even more importantly, what do people want? And so this is much after meetings with key stakeholders in town, with users, with local retailers, with local developers, so forth and so on, to come up. You don't just start throwing things down just because they might fit there. Okay? So that's final concept plans. You can even start adding in additional graphics. You know, we can start going into 3D now. This is a West Dallas project, again, that our planner did. You know, it's setting that vision. It's what do you want this to be? You don't have to set it down to exactly what every building's going to look like, but you all are driving it. So tell people tell developers what you want. Developers will come in and ask you for as much money as they can possibly get. And let me talk about that again on public-private partnership. Developers are not hard to work with. If they know the rules, you can put tight rules together. The problem is the rules need to be fair and consistent and evenly handed. And I, as a developer, can't go in and have you change the rules because it changes my costs. So sometimes after these plans, we put in infrastructure potential costs, opinions of probable costs. And we think that's important for you to have as well, because again, private investment follows public infrastructure investment. And finally, the real cutting edge of what's going on in the country and around here, I deal with this in small towns to large towns, is public-private partnerships, or P3s. That's the big push right now. It's more than just offering incentives. It includes a whole partnership where you are a joint venture with the developer. Now that's scary to a lot of public sector people that are like, oh, you can't play with the private sector like that. You can. And those that are driving development right now. It shows the city's progressive. But it starts again all the way back to the vision. It starts with plans and financial pro formas. And I would tell you that you need to know as much as the developers you're chasing. Once we start putting together a mixed-use plan, you're going to have developers come to you and say, well, I can't make this work unless I have $12 million. How do you know that? How do you know that he's telling you the truth? Well, you need to be as smart as he needs to be. You need to be able to say, well, you know, we've run the numbers through consultants or whatever, and we think your gap's probably going to be more like $6 million, not $12 million. And so therefore, our partnership, our incentives, our land lease, whatever the case may be, needs to be a different number. So you can't go in just and trust the developers. I'm not saying developers are crooked. I'm just saying, how would you know? And as keepers of the public tax money, how do you know that you're generating your return on your investment correctly if a developer needs 12 million when in fact all they need is 6 million? That makes sense, sort of. So P3s are kind of the hot thing going right now. It's what I do mostly, is running pro formas and plans and bringing developers to town, things like that. Questions?
Yeah, a question to you and Aaron both. So let me preface it with something I've heard ever since I've been on the council for 6 years, 7 years. Sometimes I hear the developers say, we're just not a friendly city for developers. We're not open, we just cause them a lot of trouble, it just takes forever to get through our process, et cetera. Now, I've also heard that you can never satisfy a developer. But my question is, do either of you have access to information that might help this board and the city council figure out whether or not we're hearing the truth or not? Because what we hear is developers are never going to tell the city manager. that they don't like his process because he may kill them down the road. So for me, it's a big dilemma, and I'm looking for a way to find an answer for that.
Well, we all know Austin's difficult, right? I mean, it has that reputation, and I can tell you as someone 25 years ago who tried to do a development in Austin, man, it's hard. It's hard to get through the system in Austin.
You know that by doing it.
I know that by doing it. I haven't been to Bastrop.
Can you provide information for us, though, from developers that, you know, you talk about working with developers. Is there anything, any information you could give us from what you know about whether what we hear is true or not?
Go ahead.
I was going to say, we're reaching out to developers. I mentioned 50 developers. That list is always changing. Several of those developers have done deals here in the past, are looking to do more deals. Some of them are maybe in the process or trying to get into that deal. So what we can do, I mean, I've heard that before. I'll be honest with you. Talking with some developers and talking with some retailers even, I've heard, hey, Bastrop's a hard town to get into. Now, whether or not that's true or not, you know, I don't know if that's a fact or not, but what we can do is talk to some of those developers, you know, that have gone through the process and get some actual information and bring that back to you maybe at another meeting so we have some, you know, actual information.
It's easy for me to do. I was a leasing agent with Steve Durham and Randy Bassett back in the 80s, and we all worked together. So, and I've had lunch with Randy recently, and I didn't ask that question, but I can.
You hear that a lot. You hear that a lot from developers because no matter what community you go to, that, it's hard to get into this community. It's hard to make a deal work here. We've heard that a few times with a couple of different developers just in my dealings, but it really hasn't been over the top. But let us go back and let us talk to some of these.
What bothers me the most is, I would expect people to say that, but what bothers me the most is when I hear people say, we're not going down there. Yeah. Just not going to do it. We know there's too much of a problem down there. We're just not going to take a risk. We're not going to go down, you know. And, you know, we have said for a long time, we want to be a business-friendly city. We're also a city that's got this extraordinarily large ETJ, overworked staff, hadn't figured out how to make the development pay for itself yet in terms of our staff, and it's a big mess, and I'd love to figure out how to deal with something with that.
Tomorrow night I'm making a presentation where we do some of what KSA does is zoning rewrites and ordinance rewrites, and what we're talking about is good ordinances and good zoning can drive good development. So to answer your question, to be business friendly, your zoning and ordinances should be simple. They shouldn't be overly complicated, and they should be published, and they should be fairly and consistently applied. That'll go a long way.
It's policy and staff.
Yeah, because I have been in towns where the policy is this, and I say, your ordinances say this, and you're telling me this. Now, I just bought this land, and I ran my pro formas based on this, and now you're telling me I got to do this, and I don't see it in your ordinances. And you can't argue with staff when there's only one or two gatekeepers that can shut your project down. So that it's a very dangerous thing for a developer to come into a community that may change the rules on it.
One last thing, it relates to this. We had a list of recommendations that we had put together back in 2010, 2011, as part of a final report after that first year. I don't know if y'all have actually maybe even seen that or not. Let me get that to you, Sean.
So. Yeah, I don't know that I've seen.
Okay, perfect.
We've had a question. We've had various times some complaints from the development community and more so the retailers on our sign ordinance. It's 43 pages long. Do you help write sign ordinances?
Yeah, it's part of the zoning and ordinance package and so forth that we
really
work with.
Need to look at that. I don't know if that's an EDC issue or a city council issue. It sort of covers both.
I don't know. I don't want you to hear that you should make it easy, as in you should have lax regulations and ordinances. Just if you build the rules this way, and they're published, and I know the rules, and you keep the rules for everybody, then I'm okay with that.
Yeah, well, that's not really the issue. The issue is, like, for example, you got an overpass, it's 35 feet tall, and the height limitation is 35 feet.
Yeah.
You know, we have that issue here, and the ordinance still says 30, so they have to come for a variance every time because our ordinances don't line up with our overpasses. But we also, there are digital signs now. Our ordinances say you just basically can't do it. You know, you can do a sign this big by this big or digital, but you can only change the information once every 5 minutes or something. It just doesn't really align itself with the technology that's out there. And so, you know, I've kind of been on this issue for a few years that, you know, I get people talking to me about the limitations on what they can do signage-wise, and our ordinance is just overly restrictive, or it seems so to me.
Well, you're not going to need signs pretty soon because your cell phone's going to tell you when you're... I did have
Stop
that
happen.
Have you all had that happen to me yet? I was in, I think it was a Home Depot. And all of a sudden I get a bing and I get a 10% off coupon. And I'm going, that's just not right. I don't need you to know that I'm in Home Depot. You just sent me in, you know.
You get a Lowe's? A Lowe's
coupon
when you're in Home Depot when you're in Lowe's.
I guess I could.
But sign ordinance refreshes are pretty common. We see refreshes of those after a certain point.
And some of communities are really tight. You know, they shall be not more than this tall, and they shall be surrounded in brick, and you know all of that. Sometimes that's fine, but I have also had this recently in a fairly large town where their ordinance said you shall be all masonry, and not much in the town was all masonry. I don't mean their sign, their entire building. Well, I had a national tenant, restaurant, a really nice sit down, and they did a cedar siding, which was really cool. They're a Texas Roadhouse spinoff. They're not Texas Roadhouse, but they're, and if you notice Texas Roadhouses, they've got cedar on the side. Well, the community wouldn't budge, and the restaurant wouldn't see you because we're going to do 56 of these in the next year, and it doesn't fit our prototype. We're not going to rebuild our entire prototype for XYZ City.
And they put up a sign saying, go down here.
And besides, I'll just come a little ways down, right, to the next town that will let me do my cedar siding. So.
And the key takeaway from what Aaron and Eric are both saying tonight is we really have to, after being here a year and stepping back and looking at our retail strategy, what we get requests from the community in our office, and Aaron's very aware of what the community requests retail-wise, we're really going to have to look at our site availability and some of what we consider retail sites today. The retailers look at it and go, it's a pasture. It doesn't have streets, it doesn't have water, it doesn't have wastewater. And then from our developer perspectives, they're looking at it going, we need a simple mechanism in place to be able to partner with the city to put a public-private partnership together in which we can put shovel-ready sites, retail commercial sites, and developments together. And they do follow the path of least resistance. These guys, if you've dealt with them at any level, they really are lazy. Tom's not here tonight, so we can say that.
Well, and right now they're very busy, and there's a lot of deals out there. We get, I work closely with one certain developer, a mixed-use developer. I mean, he's getting a deal a day almost, just somebody saying, hey, what a great idea here.
Yeah.
Little Elm, Texas just came out with an RFQ for a 25-acre mixed-use site the city owns, you know, and it's, here it is, we're going to provide the land, boom, 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 and I get those once a week, probably. Saying, come on, come to our town. Okay.
This was part of our educating the community, educating the board. We'll actually take Aaron and Eric's presentation. It'll be part of the board meeting that's televised, but we're also going to break it out so that people can share just this portion of it. We appreciate their time and for coming out this evening.
Thank you. Moving on to our action items. 4.1 is an update from the Bastrop Fine Arts Guild, as well as consideration, discussion, and possible action related to an overview of the status of the existing BEDC grant and performance agreement between the Bastrop Fine Arts Guild and the BEDC as per the direction of the BEDC board from the April meeting.
Eric, I'll put my remote.
Hold on, you left it on the table.
They didn't return it.
So as part of the board meeting last month, Carol's presentation, the Fine Arts Guild presentation didn't run, and so we asked them to come back, and we've met with them in person once, and we've had a couple conversations on the phone, swapped many emails. They're going to provide an update on their project, and then we do have a piece of recommendation action for the board to take related to a portion of what we discussed last month. Do you want the remote, or do you want me to do it?
Okay.
I can do it.
Are you going to do it?
I will. Or do you want it?
I'll do it. Let's take a vote.
We can do it. Actually, yeah. Is this one moving forward?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Well, I'm terribly sorry that Aaron and Eric left, because I was going to tell them how delighted I was to be to come up after them to show them that what we are trying to produce right now and that what we are reviewing with you is a mixed-use lifestyle development, which was the premier thing of what they were talking about doing. And I think in going over this, we wanted to quickly remind you of what was there before. This is what that 1.25 acres looked like, just right diagonally from this city hall. And what the inside looked like, the existing interior, the silos, lovely site. And what we put together was the pre-construction components and for the deconstruction. And this is one of the reasons that we believe that we were in compliance with the date of January 2015, because you couldn't start construction without deconstructing the main part of the building. And that started in November of 2014. The land was purchased in March 23rd of 2012. Architects hired, bids received, deconstruction began. It was completed in February of 2015. Metal and reclaimed wood have been stored on site. This essentially shows you when we first did this is just a November of 2014, when we actually drove in the first stake for the fence that would be going around the property for the deconstruction. This is pictures of the deconstruction. Every piece of metal was hand unscrewed and removed from that building, and it will be reused in not the new big building, but in areas of the whole area, different parts of the areas. The wood was not as usable as we had hoped. When we took the metal peeling off, there was a lot of termite damage and a lot of wood rot. So we did not and were not able to reclaim nearly as much of that loblolly pine as we had hoped. It also destabilized the building when we removed the metal sheeting, and where we wanted to hand remove the wood, we were unable to do that, and so it became too dangerous. The structural engineer called us and said, you cannot remove this wood by hand. We preserved certain items that we thought were particularly unique. These are the scales that were outside that were used for a long, long time on the property, and we've got some other lovely pieces, including the old steam engine that Clyde Clarty used to have on the property. That will be coming back downtown. This is the vision. They talked about vision. Well, we had one, a big one, one that most of the people in Bastrop thought we were crazy, and a thought that may not ever happen. And this is the latest rendering of the building. The building is 12,000 square feet. It has seven, I'll go on to here, I get a little dry. This was our vision for the future, a 12,000 square foot building, 5,000 square feet of gallery and exhibition space. That includes the big gallery as well as all of the major hallways. The mezzanine floors up above, all of that will be lobby and gallery space. 1,000 square feet of classroom space.
That classroom space is dividable, 3,000 square feet of leasable retail space. That is 7 offices, 6 on the second floor and 1 on the first floor in the southwest corner. That is the largest office. 3,000 square feet of lobby, reception, executive director's office, gift shop, kitchen, not a commercial kitchen, restrooms, 4 restrooms, 2 on each floor, and mechanical rooms and mezzanine gallery in second floor. Ownership, repurposing, and rehabilitation of 1.28 acres, 50 parking spaces, sidewalks, curbs, new electric pole, and street light. This is the concept of the gallery interior. I think you can see that that looks a whole lot better than when it was a car shop. One of the things we like to point out that the artwork that you see in this slide is our actual Bastrop artist artwork that was worked into this slide by the architects. This is the outside portion. This is an aerial view of the 12,000 square foot building. This also shows the water feature, which we just received one of the 2 mega grants from LCRA for $50,000 for that water feature. It is an aerial, it is designed to follow the river, the lower Colorado River, as it goes through Bastrop and parts of South Texas. As an educational item, we are also planting grasses as we go from the top, which is the north end where the reflector pool will be, as you go down through and go all the way to the south end of the building where it fills into the actual rainwater collection system, which will continually keep that water pumping. We will have grasses and indicators of kind of the natural areas so that it's an educational tool as well as a really beautiful feature and relaxation feature. You have the 4 studios in the back, the 4 silos in the back. You see that right behind the parking area. There will be a ceramic silo, a glass silo, a wood silo for sculpting, and the 4th silo nearest the back is being redone as an efficiency apartment with a loft bedroom and a small living area, kitchen, and bathroom. So we will have artists in residence that can come here, go into contract with us, provide classes, bring traveling shows, also provide workshops and things for people in the community. And so that is a full service area. Over on the far left at the top, you see a little gray square. That is a small sound stage that will be available for music and events. So we see this whole area as an area for community to gather, for weddings, quinceañeras, all kinds of things. These are the revenues that have been raised to date. I'm gonna have to get closer because I'm sorry. I've tried to make these bigger, but they came from another program and I can't do it.
Do you have an extra copy?
This is not the same thing. The initial donors, the individual donors, to date have given $288,817.75. I won't go through everything else, but you have each one of the grants. I want you to notice that BEDC land purchase, $100,000 was the first grant. Oh, wonderful. Great for you. Scooch just a little. I can go through that pretty well. That was matched by a Collins Foundation grant that was discretionary, $100,000. Then we also had another discretionary $100,000 partnership commitment from the city. Following that, the city invested another $300,000. And that was to pay off, they asked specifically that it be used to pay off the land, and that was done. We have had a $6,000 grant from Shield Ayers, a $20,000 2-year grant, 10,000 one years and 10,000 the next, that was discretionary, $2,500 from LCRA earlier. the architectural design and deconstruction grant of $488,000+. That is the Art Place grant, one of the most prestigious national grants ever given to anyone. We were only three projects in Texas were given one of those grants. Two of them were in Austin, and ours was in Bastrop, and ours received the most money of any of the grants, in Texas. The discretionary sculpture garden, that $2.5 million, that came from the Great American Insurance Company. That is actually Asplundh. It came through the settlement with Bluebonnet. And after all of the individual personal settlements had been done. An additional discretionary sculpture garden grant of $2,500 came, and then $75,000 architectural design staff, $50,000, and that was the NEA grant. The National Endowment for the Arts is another one of the most prestigious Our Town grants. You have to do that in partnership with the city. The city has to recommend you, and the city worked with us and made the recommendation that we receive that grant. Total, we have received and raised $3,544,800. Scooch over just a little bit to the left, will you? I want to make sure I know what the three. Actually, total raised, those are the grants. That's the grant totals. So total with the $216,000 or more from the individuals, we have raised $3.7 million toward this building. Endowments, these are also, I think, very important. We want you to understand how much really valuable expertise we have had on this project. We are artists, we are not big, huge developers, and we don't build $5 million projects very often, and ever. And so we have had $88,000 of environmental risk assessment that was done because we qualified with TCEQ and EPA to do their brownfield site assessment. Therefore, they did all of the testing, all of the drilling, all of the underground water testing, and that actually ended up being a little over $88,000 of funds that we would have had to pay. Well, actually, Clyde Clardy would have had to pay to have that land tested. And we have gone through the voluntary cleanup program. Initial construction estimates. This was an individual who gave us first phase one, phase two, and phase three estimates on this building, and he did that in kind. He gave us a fairly sophisticated or in-depth, detailed construction documents that we could have to begin to even look at the cost of this. I believe the overall cost of that, his estimate was $3,500,000 or $3,800,000. Then the next is the building supervisor. This is a donation of Mark Johnson's time from Bluebonnet. Mark Johnson has headed up more than 14 Bluebonnet projects, all of about $4 to $6 million. His time, he meets with us on a weekly basis. His time has been is valued at more than $60,000. The lead architect, Sergio Altamirano, is also working with us. It is going to be a LEED certified building, and his donation of time is also equal to about $60,000. Legal services have come from Joe Grady Tuck and also from Sarah Altamirano out of Bluebonnet. So all total, we have had approximately $238,000 in actual in-kind contributions toward this project. So Now, where are we in the project? These are the next, these are, and you can probably make these a little bit bigger.
Okay.
I'll try to go through with you exactly where we are. Okay, right here, you have all of the pre-construction cost. The land purchase was $459,000. $400,000 of that was provided by BEDC, $300,000 by the city, and $59,000 was in interest. That was a 15-year note that was paid off in 3 years. So there is no balance due there. The architectural plans, this is for multiple sets of plans. $495,000 in master design plans, blueprints for the initial drawings, redrawings after meetings with the city, and final construction blueprints. Deconstruction of the building was estimated at $168,000. It ended up being only $120,000. That has totally been paid. And so before ever beginning construction, $1 million was gone in that pre-construction aspect of the project. Any questions on that part? The project construction, this is for the major building, $3,502,188. Lead certification, this is a consultant who has to go over the chain of custody of all of the lead required aspects of everything in the project. We have to have a chain of custody of where everything is taken to, if it's recycled, where it goes, and everything else. So that $12,500 of that has been paid, so there is a balance on the other side of $12,500. The silos are estimated at $217,000. The landscape and irrigation has been estimated at $110,000. Initially, it was at $244,000. We have gone through and are continuing to go through, and I will tell you right now that next week these figures will change. We are still value engineering throughout every single week of this project. We value engineer. You get to a point where you have to stop value engineering. We can't value engineer the steel anymore because it's already gone up. But we have value engineered and had the great fortune of having all of these experts help us with this all the way along. So what we have as a total, I will if you want me to, but what you have up there is divisions, and this is not nearly divided in the 50 or 60 so scenarios or components that the contractor has on his weekly construction cost sheets. And we do meet weekly for reviewing all these features, continuing to do value engineering, to look at change orders, and to look at requests for information from different subs. So currently, the project total is $3,947,591. It started at $4,102,050. We have paid already $906,000, which is that figure at the very top underneath the million previously. We have paid $12,500 of the $25,000. We have not paid any on the silos. That's in a separate phase. We're building this in three phases, but this is the total project cost. $50,000, the water treatment, $110,000 is a landscape. We have not paid anything on the landscaping yet because obviously we're not at that stage. $72,719 is the water feature cost. $50,000 of that is in blue because that is the money that is coming from. It is not here yet, but it has been, it is getting ready to be announced, and we have been awarded and already received a letter that we have been awarded that money from LCRA. We have on hand in the bank $1,562,937. We have pledges of $74,358.67. And our pledges have been coming in on a very regular basis, and we feel that they're very dedicated to this project. So essentially, we have paid $2,606.44467. So we are $1.5 million shy of what we would need to complete the whole project. We are building in phases, as I said. So the next thing you have on this is phase one, which is the main building, all of the infrastructure, the lead, and that's pretty much it. And when I say all of the infrastructure, I'm talking about all of the electrical, all of the plumbing that has been run, all of the sidewalks, all of the street, all of the parking, all of the curbs, basically everything around the building except the silos and the field and the water plant, water structure and that sort of thing. So for that portion, we need $3,527,188. And if you scroll to the left, I believe we are right at $970,000 short of that at this particular time. The phase two is the silo in stages. That's $217,000. And the sound stage is $20,684, so that's another $237,684. Ground phase three is the grounds. That will be the last thing. That will be the landscaping and irrigation. Some of that has already gone in terms of piping and that sort of thing, but I have not split that cost out. The water feature and the rainwater collection system. That's another total of $156,137. So that makes us one, all in total, I believe it's 100 and, where did we go to the total?
It's the red number.
There it is, $1,320,459.33 short on these figures. Next slide, please. Where do we find this funding? It is fairly miraculous that since we bought this property and our fundraising steering committee came into effect in 2013, that in a little over 2 years, we raised almost $3,500,000 and then more in the individual contributions, all the way up to almost $3,800,000. We have a grant in. We have done extraordinarily well. 75% of the grants we have applied for, we have received. Maybe not everything, but part or all. The Meadows Foundation grant has been submitted. It is for $400,000. There is a Fondren Foundation construction grant that has been submitted. It is for $100,000. We are in discussions right now with the Moody Foundation. I hope to have a meeting with Ross Moody in Austin next week to discuss this project with him. That will be a minimum of $400,000. We are looking at the Ford Foundation grant. They are very, very, very difficult. You have to put a letter of intent in, then they let you know if they are interested, and then you put in an application for the grant. Grants are no guarantee, so the final item on the list down there is a possible line of credit. We have talked about this project from the very beginning, that our goal was to open the doors of this project without any debt retirement at all. Everyone told us that's unbelievable, that's almost impossible, can't imagine you can even think about that. That is still our goal. I want you to know that that is still our goal. and that we are working like crazy on it. But we are also exploring everything that we have to explore to make sure that this completes itself on time and not ahead of time like our builders wanted to do in June. So that is where we are on the funding of the project. The next thing that you have is not a part of this presentation, but I would like to show you, I will leave you with what this building looked like last Friday. You can already see the second floors, two flights of stairs are in, the steel structure is up, the support beams in the ceiling are up, there will be big, much bigger, long timber rafters that will be in the two-story gallery portion. And you can also see, and I didn't put the slide in, but we have some nice little curbs now and some area of parking that's getting done. So we are moving very strongly, very quickly. Our contractor is working very hard with us. We actually, because of fundraising and some of the grants, we asked them to try to not move it up into June or July, but the date that we had talked about in September to finish construction. So that is what we are looking at. We are very strongly moving in this direction. This is a 12,000 square foot building. It has 7 offices. And the last and final thing that you have here is you asked for an updated maintenance, first year maintenance and operation budget. And I have provided those for you here. I will real quickly, I will tell you, and they basically have an explanation. So I can let you look at them. I can run through the numbers with you. The projected first year of income is based on our income from art sales for 2015 and what we have done as of April of this year, which I think is tremendous because in 2015 we had $44,000 of sales of art, and in April, since April of this year, through April of this year, we've had over $60,000 in art. So we projected, we were using the $45,000 figure, and we doubled that because we think that capability is there. There is going to be a lot more art. There is going to be traveling art. There are going to be visiting artists, renowned artists. So we doubled that figure. We have $40,000 in grants, which is very conservative. We'll continue to use grants and apply for program grants. Endowment fund will be started. We figure $50,000 is not too ambitious a start. Classroom income, this is based, and we have talked with numerous people about their classroom space. And Patricia Randulik, our executive director, has called workshops and classes around the state from other places. They basically charge $20 an hour for their rooms. I have conservatively estimated income at $10 an hour based on 2 classrooms being utilized only 50% of the time. We think we will do far better than that, but we would rather underestimate income and overestimate expenses. $6,000 a year coming in off of the gift shop. Fundraising events, $40,000, that's been broken down for you between the circle of friends. This is not everything that the gala makes. This year's gala made over $70,000. The largest, biggest, most successful gala we have ever had. It was our 10th anniversary. $15,000 for the Lost Pines Regional Art Conference. Online competitions, membership dues, event revenues. This is for special events out in the garden area, and I have, for one, and I know Patricia has also, wedding venues are just for the venue, not for preparing anything or doing anything or anything else, but just for the space alone, are going anywhere between $2,500 and $5,000 or more. So we have estimated a small use for that. The glass silos, we have estimated these, and I will tell you that we have master glass people in our art guild now, and they are well known. They came from Phoenix. They know glass artists all over the country. Mark Rendulik has put together one of the most sophisticated glass proposals I have ever seen for a glass blowing facility. He has talked with numerous people about this. We already have glass blowers calling saying, when will this be open? When can we come rent this space? They rent for $50 per hour the space to use, to come in and use your facilities. There will be always someone on site with them that is a mastered or a very expert glass maker. Same with the ceramic and same with the wood. We think the glass silo will be actually by far the most successful and exciting thing for a long, long time. The retail space, this is 7 retail offices. We have used 2 different figures from 2 different commercial realtors here in town. They both gave us $2 a square foot. We did use that. We broke all of the 7 retail spaces down so that you could see the exact number of square footage of each of these spaces. And we charged the $210 for the premium space on the southwest corner on the first floor. So the total income is projected at $381,700. Projected first year expenses, we try to overestimate. Advertising at $50,000. Artist commission is not overestimated unless we have overestimated sales. That will be at 60% of the sales, so that's a deduction of $54,000 right there. Gallery supplies, office supplies, gift shop expenses, artist receptions, the license that we have to play music inside our building, insurance at $15,000. We'll get additional estimates on insurance. Art center utilities, this is based on the city giving me the average utility bill of a 12,000 square foot manufacturing company here in the city, and it was for a 12,000 square foot building. So we used that figure and calculated $19,440. Then we also calculated in, and for the glass silo, it's going to be between $300 and $500 a month, and the wood and the ceramic silo is probably going to add another $100 each of those silos. We're using a lot of gas instead of electricity, and so those will be $7,200 a year. Accounting and bookkeeping, $15,000. Salaries for, and this is an area that we have to discuss, salaries for our executive director and 2 additional part-time staff people who would only come to 2 full-time equivalent employees. That figure is not in line with this contract. Withholding, Social Security, Medicare, grant writer, postage, printing, yard and building maintenance, and total projected expenses, $343,643, which gives us reserve funds in the first year of $38,057 for any debt retirement, unexpected expenses, whatever else might occur.
No. Go ahead.
No. Okay, what else?
Oh, wait, I have a couple questions or comments.
Okay.
Go ahead, I'll let you.
So at this point, the only recommendation that staff is making to move forward on this is, because construction has started, you know, whether you use the deconstruction date or the actual groundbreaking for the facility, we need to bring them into compliance with Section 5.9 of when they started construction and kind of set that date.
Right.
Y'all can decide which date you want to use as a board, whether you want to use the January, February of 15 date, or you want to use the October of 15 date when they actually had the groundbreaking for the construction of the building to go vertical. Staff's making no recommendation on that, but we did provide a motion in the memo to kind of bring them in compliance with Section 5.9. But we also are continuing to recommend that, you know, from the motion that Gary made last month, is that we continue to work with the Guild on any other items that the board may see concern of or that develop through the process.
I just want to make a couple of comments. Thank you, Carol, for an in-depth overview.
Yeah.
Just a couple of things I look at, and without sounding negative, you know, hope doesn't sell anything. And we say that in our industry all the time.
That's right.
Hope and sit at your desk and wait for the numbers to come in.
That's right.
So based on that and based on the gap that we have, one of the things I'd like to see in your projected first year expense, and that is a line of credit. You're making an assumption that you're going to raise the 1.3 or get it in a short period of time, but yet your projected expenses, you're saying they're conservative, but I don't see that line item. I'd like to see that in there.
Mm-hmm.
It is what it is.
Yeah.
If at the end of the day you show a negative, then let's show that negative and let's figure out what needs to be done. That's just me personally.
I agree.
But from that perspective, that's the only comment I have.
I agree. I can tell you that that is something that we have been looking at. Very carefully.
It's not
like
a negative thing if you get to the end of the line.
It's just like
if
we get to the end and we can't quite get there and everybody was right, it was totally impossible to do without having some kind of debt retirement,
sure.
Then we'll deal with that. And we are looking at that already.
Perfect.
Okay, any other questions, comments? Would anyone on the board like to make a recommendation the staff has suggested?
What were the two dates?
I got down here without the folder from the Art Guild.
In the last extension,
I have
October. Was January 2015.
Yeah, January 2015 was the date in the October at altered contract agreement. So, if you
is it on? This is the last.
In the last packet.
Okay.
So if you want to use, the deconstruction date of 11/14, then I suppose it depends on when because.
Well, let me ask you, Sean.
Yeah.
What's the point?
It sets the clock for completion, is what it does. So they have, from the day they broke ground, they have 24 months to complete the facility and to receive their CO and start operations.
I think with the progress they've made, I'd say, well, let's give them some time to get it done.
I'm fine with a later date to give them the time. I'm more specifically interested in the communication and the interaction moving forward so that we do see it to the end.
Yeah.
And we do see it to the end properly. So that's why I was asking for a later date.
I'll be honest with you.
The official groundbreaking was October
12th. October 12th.
2015.
Of 2015.
And that's why the date matters, is because that date triggers the completion date. And by going with the October 24th, they basically will have until 2017 to complete the facility and be up and operational. If you go with the earlier date when the deconstruction started, they have less time.
Our estimating.
I'm prepared to make
but
a motion.
It's 24 months for all
months,
three phases.
That's great. We like that.
I move that the Bastrop Board of Directors, Bastrop's Fine Arts Guild, with the initiation of construction date of October 12, 2015, is in compliance with Section 5.9 of its performance agreement with the Bastrop EDC. EDC staff is also instructed to continue working with the Guild on remedying any other conflicts in the agreements and keeping the board informed.
So is that the give them more time or less time?
Gives them more time.
Gives us a subcontractually.
That's all I want to do.
I'll second.
Yeah.
And it brings us into contractual compliance, if I'm not mistaken, Jesse.
Okay, I think the only contractual issue that I would like to make clear on is whether or not, and if you're allowing Sean the authority to communicate with us to possibly adjust the full-time equivalency employment. The 4B funds...
Part of this agreement was that the staff will, motion was that staff will continue to work
correct.
With you.
Yeah, we'll
so we'll address
okay.
that.
Okay.
And there's a
so
motion
that's,
on the table.
Yeah,
okay.
It was just the compliance of 5.9 was the issue.
Okay.
So we have a motion on the table. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion passes. Thank you, Carol.
Thanks, Carol.
Thank you very much. Mayor, do you mind if I have just 1 minute to address your comments to Eric or Madam Chair? We have encountered some issues. You wanted to know about problems or difficulties.
Yeah,
we can address those later.
Why don't you tell me offline?
Yeah, why don't we do that later?
But we have had some issues that have caused...
Love to hear from you.
Have caused delay and everything. I'm hoping to be on your schedule Thursday.
Item...
So
thank you very much.
Item 4.2.
So item 4.2, 4.3, and 4.4 are all related to a project in which we have a performance agreement for the board to consider taking action on tonight. The prospect is here. We probably need to meet with the board briefly in executive session to go over this. Before y'all take action, and I know we have a crowd here, it would probably be in our best interest to move into executive session so we can go through the performance agreement with y'all, go through what y'all are going to be doing, and then come back out, and then we can clear up the rest of the executive session items after everybody's, after we finish with that.
So are you anticipating that these folks will wait around for the short executive session?
Some of them will, yes.
I mean, would it be possible to put all the executive sessions at the end? Or?
I know at least the press and some of the folks in the room are going to be here for us to take action on this, on these three
this
specific
is, these
items.
Are, these are important. If these are
four,
important, that's fine.
4, 2, 3, 4.
No, I understand. Yeah. If that's what everybody's here for, that's great.
Not everybody, but some of them.
A lot of people. Well,
yes.
So you want to go back in the back room?
Yes. So I get to read all this. Where am I at?
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
Before you do that, do we have anyone that's on tap further down that is going to be short?
Well, that's
what... Instead of making them stay here?
I'm hoping this won't take long.
Okay, let's go. Go ahead.
I think we're either way. The BEDC Board of Directors will meet in closed executive session pursuant to the Texas Government Code Chapter 551 to discuss the following, Section 551.071(1)(a) and Section 551.0712, consultation with attorneys threatened and or contemplated claims, causes, or litigation, and or matters upon which the attorney has a duty and or responsibility to advise or report to the governmental body. Section 551.072, deliberations about real property, including but not limited to potential sales, acquisition, exchanges, leases, dispositions, or values of the following real properties: Project Bronze Star, Gold Steel, Star Wars, and or property owned and or considered for acquisition used by the BEDC. And finally, Section 551.087, deliberations regarding economic development negotiations, Project Bronze Star, Gold Steel, MT Star Wars, JetBlue, Valley Stays, and or White Foam.
I might add, well done, Sean. He wanted
Chinese.
Yeah, the board is back from executive session at 7:52. We are on item 4.2, consider discussion and possible action on approval of economic development agreement between the BEDC and Project Gold Steel. Do we have a motion to approve the agreement?
I do move that we approve the economic development agreement between the Bastrop Economic Development Corporation and ADI Technologies, Inc.
I second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion passes.
Item 4.3, consideration, discussion, and possible action on a resolution by the Bastrop Economic Development Corporation authorizing BEDC Board Chair Steve Mills and or Executive Director Sean Kirkpatrick to execute all necessary contracts and related documentation necessary to finalize the conveyance of 1.4 acres of land in the Bastrop Business and Industrial Park to ADI Technologies, Inc. in conjunction with the approval of the economic development agreement that was just approved.
I move the board approve resolution number 05162016-1.
I second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion passes.
Item 4.4, consideration, discussion, and possible action on adoption of statutory findings related to Project
are related to AEI Technologies Incorporated, which upon adoption waives the mandated public hearing for Type B corporations as per state law, section 505.15 of the Texas Local Government Code. Cam, you have the motion.
Yes. In consideration of the information presented to the board by the staff and the applicant, AEI Technologies, Inc., and because the board finds that the expenditure of funds by the EDC for the AEI Technologies project related to the development of a medical equipment manufacturing facility in the Bastrop Business and Industrial Park would, one, create or retain primary jobs, and two, has been found by the board of directors of the BDC to be an industrial manufacturing project, and three, is therefore an authorized project pursuant to section 501.101 of the local government code. I move that the board approve the expenditure for the ADI Technologies project under the authority granted by section 505.159B of the local government code, and direct the staff to move forward immediately to seek council approval of the project.
A second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion passes.
So, AEI Technology, its owner Phil Love is here with us tonight. Phil has been great to work with. We've been working with him for probably 6 or 7 months now. I've got a press release for the press to cover this, and we'll email it to y'all so it makes it a whole lot easier tomorrow. But we're excited to have Phil and his company coming to Bastrop here in the near future.
Welcome. Thank you.
Gold steel.
I'm glad we're in Pittsburgh. So.
Do you want to take just a moment and say what kind of industry?
So they manufacture medical device equipment, testing equipment for R&D research, and Phil's an engineer and can explain it a whole lot better than I can.
AEI Technologies is, we've been around for quite a while. I've owned the company for the last 13 years, and we sell over the world. We're recognized as the gold standard for respiratory gas analysis, and we primarily measure oxygen consumption, CO2 production, as primarily used for research, but also for clinical and for teaching purposes. Yeah, it's very, very high tech, and nobody understands what I do.
Oxygen's one of our
Again, why I can't explain what they do. For the dozenth time you've explained it to me, and I still don't understand it. But I know we're glad to have you here, Phil, and we'll get with you in the morning. Thank
you
very much.
We've all looked at your website.
Oh, okay. So.
That helps. Pictures help.
Yes. We are redoing our website. So it's a very, very old website.
Excellent.
Okay. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Moving on to five, update and reports. 5.1, the EDC projects and or business update.
Well, in your package, you should have the report from me. It has been a busy meeting month. We have had several site visits in the last couple of weeks, and have a couple more that we're trying to get scheduled. We're seeing lots of good activity on the primary job recruiting side of what we do, and I think I've got this one. Yes, there we go. So you've got my meeting, the meetings I've been to. The budget schedule is attached. So what we're looking at budget timeline-wise is doing a preview at the June meeting, looking at June 11th for a special meeting in the first budget workshop. July 11th, sorry. At the July 18th regular board meeting, going through any revisions or changes or anything else we need to add. If we need another workshop, we're looking at August 8th. We're looking at adoption in the public hearing at August 15th and doing our presentation to the City Council on the 23rd of August with the two readings of the Council September 13th and 27th. We also included in there kind of our board training schedule. As you had the retail coaching KSA today, We'll do a budget preview in June. Mike Barnes with the Barnes Group will be back July 18th to kind of talk about strategic planning and where we are with what we worked on with him last year and where we're going for the next 12 months. That discussion will help us kind of hone our budget focus in the areas that the board wants to focus on within our strategic plan, going to the budget adoption. And then the September 9th meeting will be when we get back on talking about other things going on within the EDC, and that is slated for looking at our primary job recruiting and kind of where we're at, where we're going with primary job recruiting. Other than that, any questions about what we're doing? The ad hoc bylaw committee will meet again in 2 weeks.
Can I have a report from what you've got so far?
So we've gone through and they've come up with quite a few recommendations. We've got some work that the staff is going to have to do as it relates to the bylaws and articles of incorporation at the Secretary of State's office. We're kind of coming up with what the recommendations are as part of what those two documents look like in the governance of the corporation. But unfortunately, I'm going to be out of the office all next week, and with the schedule this week, it'll be that first week in June when we'll get the committee back together to kind of go through the articles and the bylaws and of course, out the process moving forward.
And when do we expect to see it back?
At the earliest, we'll see something back at the June meeting.
It is, I think that, if I'm not mistaken, this process started when I asked on behalf of some others that we take a look at an issue about having council members on this board. And is that under consideration?
It is under consideration. And the committee has some very strong viewpoints on what they believe the course of action, that they're going to recommend, but they really do want to hear from the public input side of what the public has to say at the forum sometime in the next few weeks.
You know, it's obvious we can operate with fewer than seven members, but it puts me and the council in an odd position that you might be talking about council members. And it's time for me to make appointments. And that means that if I hold off on that to hear what they have to say, I can't make any appointments before the June meeting, or maybe the July meeting, until the council comes back and deals with it. So, it's pretty unfortunate timing from my perspective. I'm not sure what I'm going to do about that, but I'm not going to appoint somebody that, you know, we decide, you know, is or isn't available to be on the board. So I just wanted to say I find that extraordinarily unfortunate from my perspective. And I want to say the following. I think that something I heard somebody say that would appeal to me. Who's the committee, by the way? Do you know who the committee is?
Christy, Steve Mills, Ashley Buschick, Sherry Sheen, and myself.
Okay. So I will say to the two of y'all who are present, if I think that the having the bylaws set up from the get-go, and it's not on the charter, but it's been, you know, universally recognized, that, you know, the mayor needs to be present on this board. I think that as I look at that, you know, there's got to be council representation on the board. And I think that's for a lot of reasons, the closeness that we have, the interaction we have, and so forth. But I would, I'm all for options. I'm not for limitations, I'm for options. So if that committee considered that an option would be for the mayor to have a person take his or her place on the board as a council member, so there's council representation, there's a council member taking place of the mayor on the board for a period of time, I would welcome that personally. And I think it's an option that other mayors would welcome in the future. So I just want to put you on the list about that.
Youth Career Day is Wednesday, and Jean and Angela have not lost all their hair yet, but getting close. We cannot get to Wednesday soon enough. VRE outreach was good. We had 7 visits in April. We'll see more after the career day is done. And if you have not noticed, the Highway 71 billboard came down. It was a happy day in Sean's world.
Where are you? Are you on city manager's report?
No, I'm on mine still. I'm on page 40.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought we had gotten to the
The Highway 71 billboard came down. They are prorating our contract with that. We will have a first option when they decide to put it back up, although nobody actually knows what they're putting back up at the moment. We have been told it's going to be a one-sided board. They're looking into whether or not it's going to be one-sided or two-sided. So that's my report. They've gone through the training schedule.
The fiber connectivity?
We're still working on that and waiting on some information from the vendors that are looking at providing that.
Do you have a timeline on that?
That is all in their realm, because it's really a private sector deal that we're just supporting. Main Street has their report in the packet. Sarah O'Brien is here.
I'm happy to answer any questions.
Tax credit workshop is coming up.
I have a question.
Sure, absolutely.
How are we doing?
We seem to be doing okay.
How are we doing?
Oh, you guys are doing a great job. I'm enjoying everything that's happening.
Okay. Good, because you're a good fresh face to tell us full of something or not. So thank you very much.
She's very diplomatic as well.
Sean did mention we are hosting a tax credit workshop on May 31st from 11:30 to 1 at the convention center. We've got a tax credit consultant who can kind of help navigate the process and something to educate some property owners and some area professionals. So encourage you guys to join us.
Yes.
And just as we retired grade supervisor, I have to acknowledge the fact that Phil Lode has been involved with our entrepreneurial ready community process since day one, and in 2012 when we got certified and we went through the process, and one of the things was we needed a score volunteer. Phil got certified as our service corps for retired executives, and he's been working with us.
Exactly.
But he has been meeting with our entrepreneurs and helping get their business plans up to
for
questions for a long time. Thank you for everything.
Yeah, comprehensive. The city manager's report, parts of it that are relative to this board start on page 45. We have cut and pasted those in there for you. I am not the person to answer questions on them.
One of my questions had been the facade grant and it's a carryover from previous year.
That is correct. Taylor Chiropractic is a carryover from the previous budget year. Sarah is working with Dr. Taylor to get that closed out as quickly as we can. He understands that we would like to get that done by the end of the year.
And are we working with them on reworking the facade grant?
Sarah is working on the application and hopefully will be with us here in the next month and we'll have something soon for the board to take a look at.
Thank you. So. Our intent is not to stop the program, but to reevaluate.
Can I make a comment on your city manager?
Absolutely.
Since Mike's not here, I don't know if he'll would share this observation or not, but I want to say, with the crowd we've had here tonight, my first meeting with EDC as mayor, I came from this building to a very, very crowded, cramped little building. And I proposed that we move out of there. And the vote was 6-1 against me. Gary will remember that. There's been a little difference in the board this year. We agreed to come meet here. And I assure you, if this group had shut up at that little place, you couldn't have gotten in there. And I remember somebody saying to me, well, why would we need more space? We'd ever have any more than this number of people here in the first place? Which means who would go to a place they knew they were going to be standing for a meeting? So I just want to compliment the board on that. And I want to say I think that the more citizen conversation we have with y'all, the participation and watching us, the better off we are. So I just think that's a really good move. And this is probably as big a crowd as we've had. And I'd love to find the time we just fill this whole place up, because what this board is doing is just so vital. Well, I think it is vital to the community, but everybody recognizes it. So I thank you all for coming, and I hope we can see more of you in the future.
Thank you.
That was a stretch for the city manager.
We've got some more executive sessions.
Are there any other items on the city manager's report, pages 45, 36, 47 on the packet? No. The next item is 5.5, City of Bastrop Comprehensive Plan Update. On 46 on the city manager's report is actually a pretty concise update. And
I had a question for you, Christy. When we had that conversation earlier, we heard from Mr. Davis about, you know, land is ultimately important and all that kind of stuff. Does the comprehensive plan deal with that kind of detail, where it would designate some things to think ahead for kind of
that
what he was talking
goal.
About?
That is the goal.
You're hoping that we'll get there, is what you're saying. You're trusting?
They're designating areas. Those
are specific.
There'll be a lot of public discussion on that.
Okay. Good. Super. Thank you.
We'll see.
You just used my favorite word, hope.
Yes, I'm sorry. The minute I said it, I knew that was wrong. I switched to trust real quick. Is that any better? Thank you.
5.6 is the construction project report that's in there. And we are done with the public session of this meeting. I have a couple more executive session items to go over with the board, but there should be no action coming out of executive session.
Then
we're in executive session.
And we thank you all for